So, hello and welcome again to the lecture course on relativity and cosmology. For the chapter 6, which is Einstein equations and its main conceptual applications, we have still two sections left. And the second to last is a section on conservation laws. Now, conservation laws are very important in physics, as you all know. By now, energy law, angular momentum, momentum. So what is the situation here? Let us first have a look at electrodynamics and charge conservation. So in special relativity, we have the conservation law that the four-dimensional divergence of the four current is zero. So d mu, j mu is zero. And from this, we get the usual conservation of charge as follows. So we integrate this over a space-time region, d4x, j mu, comma mu of x. And of course, this is zero again. And then we use Gauss's theorem to transform this into a surface integral over the boundary of the space-time region. So this is the integral over the omega, d3 sigma mu, times j mu. Let us envisage the following situation. So we have a finite region with a non-vanishing current. So maybe here in space. And so this over time gives a certain space-time region that we call a world tube. So here this is the region where j mu is non-vanishing, no? And that's the world tube. Now let us introduce a normal vector to these spatial parts. So we have here outward pointing normal, and then it would mean that here this would be inward pointing, the same normal vector. Here we extend this here to infinity, so this is a space-like slice, and here also. So let us call this sigma, and this sigma prime. So this refers to, say, x0 is equal constant, and this refers to x prime 0 is a constant. No? So this is an initial time and a final time, and we have a finite region of non-vanishing electromagnetic current. Now we can apply this integral here. So if we have the boundary here and here, and because here there is no field, we only have these contributions from here and from here. So this is integral over sigma d3 sigma mu times j mu. And then the contribution from sigma prime, but you see here that here the normal vector is pointing outwards and here it's inwards, but the convention for this integral is an outward n, so we get a minus sign here, no, from this. And so we have minus integral sigma prime d3 sigma mu times j mu. And if we adapt coordinates, recall we had this when we did integration, so we call this x0 equals constant, x prime equals 0 equals constant. So it's just a d3x and a d3x prime. So this here is then integral d3x j0 minus integral d3x j0. So this is over sigma and this is over sigma prime. So this is the total charge that is contained here. And this here is the total charge Q prime that is contained here. And so if the whole is zero, it means that Q is equal to Q prime. Yeah, so from here you get that Q is equal to Q prime. So we have a conservation of electric charge in time. That's of course what we know and what is a central property of electrodynamics. Okay, this calculation refers to special relativity, but we can easily extend it to general relativity. So in general relativity, we have, as you recall, the covariant divergence vanishing. And we can integrate this, so we have this j mu semicolon mu that vanishes. So let us integrate this over a space-time region with the invariant volume element, and of course this is zero. And we can also write this in the following way. So this is the integral d4x square root of minus g j mu comma mu. Now recall the property that for a vector density of weight 1, the covariant derivative coincides with the ordinary divergence. The covariant divergence agrees with the ordinary divergence. We also call this the density j mu. And so this then, according to Gauss, gives a surface integral square root of minus g j mu. Well, okay, you can have here the curled j. And this is, of course, similar to what we have here. So if this is zero, we again can argue, as before, the charge is conserved. So similar to special relativity situation. And so you get from here that q is equal to q prime. So the electric charge conservation survives by going from special to general relativity, as it must, because electrodynamics is its consistency is based, of course, on that property. But you can see it formally. Now, important is, of course, also the momentum and the energy. And here we have the four-dimensional momentum, which includes energy, and the three-dimensional momentum. So what about the four momentum? So let us first have a look at special relativity. There we have the total four momentum, p mu, or let me call it a capital P mu, is an integral over sigma d3 sigma nu times t u nu. So this is the total four momentum. The zero component of this is the total energy. So E, which is P0, is the total energy. Yeah, and the spatial part is the three-dimensional momentum. The same holds for the angular momentum, which I will not write down here. Now, how is the situation in G? I mean, here, of course, we have T mu nu comma nu equals to zero. And this is why we have here the conservation of the four momentum. So you can apply an argument similar to here. You're just the same situation, and instead of j mu comma mu equals zero, we will have t mu nu comma nu equal to zero. Now, in general relativity, as you know, this has been replaced by t mu nu semicolon u equal to zero. The covariant divergence is vanishing. So can we apply a similar argument as for the charge? So in GR, we have zero is T mu nu semicolon nu. Now let us write this out by inserting the definition for the covariant derivative. So you will, and I leave this as an exercise, get the following terms. You will get this term here, first term, and that, if this were the only term here, then you could apply the argument as here to the right hand side for the charge and conclude that the four momentum is conserved, because this is just the ordinary derivative and you integrate over square root of minus g times d4x. But you get a second term. So this second, there's a new term, minus one half d g nu lambda over d x mu t nu lambda. And this additional term prevents the application of this argument. Yeah, you can now integrate over d4x and use this property here, but you will not get from this the conservation of this integral. So because of this term, we have non-conservation of four momentum. Now, why that? The reason is that if you have a gravitational field, then the matter four momentum is not conserved by itself. Already the case in the Newtonian limit. So, can we add an appropriate contribution from gravity to have, say, a total momentum of matter and gravity? This is unfortunately not possible because of the equivalence principle. If you had an energy momentum tensor of the gravitational field, then, I mean, you would have a contradiction to the equivalence principle, because locally you can always transform the gravitational field away. And so you cannot attribute it locally a well-defined energy momentum tensor. There cannot be such a tensor quantity. Now, people have thought about this already very early, and I will not enter the discussion in detail. You can introduce what is called a pseudo energy momentum tensor. Landau and Lifshitz have done that, and you can find details in their famous textbook, the second volume, where they introduce a T mu nu for the gravitational field, but this is not a tensor, it's only a tensor under linear coordinate transformation. So what do we do? Well, we dispense here with this energy momentum conservation locally, and what we can have in general relativity are expressions for the total energy and the total momentum as surface integrals. So in GR, total energy and momentum can be expressed as a surface integral at infinity, at spatial infinity, but not for the most general case, for the case where we have an asymptotically flat space-time. So we assume we have a localized region of masses, and that outside this localized region, the gravitational field decays to zero asymptotically. And then if you go far away, where you are approximately flat space-time, then you can have a big surface, S2, and you integrate a certain expression that I write down, and you get a total energy and momentum. Yeah, so this is important in asymptotically flat space-time. In particular, there are various definitions of energy that can be applied in various situations, also in situations with gravitational waves. The simplest, and which is certainly useful if we have a static situation, is the so-called ADM energy. So we have, in particular, an expression for the total energy. So this is P0. And I just cite this without further discussion. So it has these prefactors, and we sum over spatial indices only, and so this is an integral over the two-sphere, so the boundary of the three-dimensional space, so a large sphere at infinity, and we have this components gij, comma j minus gj, j, comma I. Now, so these are the spatial components of the metric, and the partial derivatives, and this is an expression that is evaluated far away from the masses in asymptotically flat space-time. So that expression turns out to be a good candidate for the total energy of everything what is inside of gravity plus matter in this space-time. So it's called the ADM energy after three people who did it in the end of the 1950s. So Arnowitt, Deser, and Miesner. And it turns out that this is really useful concept for the energy, for example, as we will later see in the Schwarzschild case, where you just have, a spherical symmetric mass, it's just m, or m times c squared. Of course, such an energy should have nice properties, and it was a long, for many years, conjecture that this is non-negative, but the actual proof of this was very hard. And only after 20 years of work, it was been able to prove. So one can prove that this energy is really non-negative. That this ADM energy is either zero or positive, and it's zero even only if the space is Minkowski space-time. This was proven by mathematicians Schön and Yao in 1979. So this is hardly accessible for ordinary physicists. It's very complicated. So the physicist Ed Witten has presented a proof in 1981 that can be understood by physicists using also methods from physics, so-called supersymmetry, which we of course have no time to discuss here. But you should keep in mind that one has a well-defined global notion of energy, and that this global notion of energy is non-negative. So this is really a highly non-trivial result, because recall the Newtonian gravity, there the potential energy, which is the minus 1 over r potential, diverges, it goes to minus infinity for r to 0. So can be arbitrarily negative, but this shows that whatever you have inside, I mean gravitational contribution and matter contribution, the total energy is non-negative. So really you avoid by this divergence of the Newtonian gravitational potential. Okay, so far for this brief mentioning of energy concepts. This also concludes 6.5, and the last section of this chapter is devoted to some general remarks on the structure of the theory, initial value problems and others. So for each of those topics, you could make maybe a whole lecture course. So these are specialized topics, but I bring them a little bit together so that you have a perspective on the structure of the theory and the work that is done in classical relativity. So in this last section, we discuss very generally some properties of the structure of the theory. Many of those topics are separate issues for lectures, and there are also some part of it is work in progress. So it's more a short overview than a detailed discussion. So recall the Einstein equations, r mu nu minus 1/2 g mu nu r is equal to kappa t mu nu. I skipped the cosmological constant, or you could also see it's included in the t mu nu. Now these are 10 coupled quasi-linear differential equations for the metric. Now remember, in Newtonian gravity we had one equation for one scalar quantity, the Newtonian potential phi of x, and this was the Poisson equation. Now we have here 10 equations, and they are partial differential equations. Only the highest, the second derivative occurs linearly. So that's the only simplification that we have here for the metric. How do we find solutions to such a complicated set of equations? So how to find solutions for this? Well, there are a priori three different perspectives, so three different methods that you could, for a given team you knew, try to find an exact solution for this. Yeah? So we shall see some cases where this works. So find for given, so team you knew given, so find exact solution for team you knew. Well, in practice, this only works for highly symmetric solutions, as we shall see for the Schwarzschild solution or solutions in cosmology. In general, you will not succeed. It's just too complicated to find here an exact solution for this equation. Okay, what would be the alternative? You could do the following. Okay, why not just inventing some team you knew of X and putting it here on the left-hand side and then see what kind of energy momentum tensor it corresponds to. And then we have an exact solution for a certain model with energy momentum. Yeah, so G mu nu given determine appropriate team mu nu. Well, this does in general not work. What you get out of this are expressions for team mu nu that make no sense for any realistic matter model. I mean, people have tried that and you get something, but it's physically irrelevant. It may be mathematically relevant, but physically irrelevant. There are a few exceptions where this has been used in physics, but in general does not work. Yeah. Leads in general to a nonsensical, I write this way, it's nonsensical team union. They do not correspond to any known or even imaginable form of matter. Now the last and maybe very relevant is the imposition of a so-called initial value problem. Initial value problem, or sometimes also called a Cauchy problem. Yeah. To proceed as one already did in Newtonian mechanics, that you specify initial conditions, say initial position and initial velocity, and then you solve the equation to get the whole trajectory. And so the idea is to proceed here in a similar way. So say on a spatial hypersurface, we give appropriate initial data, and then we can determine for the whole of space-time the metric. You know, so this here means determine g mu nu of x from appropriate initial data. Of course, this cannot be uniquely, but uniquely up to coordinate transformation. Let me give at least some details on about this. I mean, so for this initial value problem, the first important remark is that, okay, we have 10 Einstein equations, but actually four of them turn out to be so-called constraints. What does this mean? Constraints mean that they do not contain second temporal derivatives. So if you imagine that we have to give, I mean, the function and its first time derivative as initial data, and then we have the second time derivative field equations to develop the evolution, then this means if I have here a field equation that has no second derivative, it's a restriction on the initial data. No, it depends only on the function and the first derivatives. And so we have to consider that we cannot arbitrarily specify initial data. No? So note that 4 of the 10 Einstein equations are constraints, and this means they do not contain second temporal derivatives, and they thus restrict possible initial data. The analogy in electrodynamics is the Gauss law. No, so there's an analogy in electrodynamics. So Gauss law is divergence of E is 4 pi rho, the charge density, and you see there are no time derivatives at all here. So this is a law that must be imposed at all times. And when you in electrodynamics impose initial conditions for the electric and magnetic field, then you cannot do this arbitrarily, of course. You must respect this law, and for the magnetic field also that it's divergence free. Otherwise you get nonsense. Now here, in GR, what are the constraints? So let me give you a very general argument. So we have this contracted Bianchi identities for the Einstein tensor, and if you just as an exercise you write explicitly the covariant derivative with the Christoffel symbols, then you get the following, that this can be written as d0 g0 mu, you know, which is the time derivative, is a minus ordinary space derivative, space divergence, and then you have two terms with the gamma. Now you see here on the right hand side, this contains at most second temporal derivatives, because the Einstein tensor has at most second derivative, and of course here you don't have, you all also have only first derivatives of the metric, and this is a spatial derivative. So the right hand side has at most second time derivatives. So this contains at most second temporal derivatives. But here you have a time derivative of g0 mu. I mean, it's only applied here to g0 mu, and this means that g0 mu can contain at most first time derivative. So here this contains at most first temporal derivatives. This means that the g0 mu equations are constraints. So this means that g0 mu equals to 0. These are 4 out of the 10 Einstein equations are constraints. This was already noticed by Leon Rosenfeld in 1930, who was the first to envisage the quantization of the gravitational field, and in that context he found that 4 out of the 10 field equations are constraints. Now, constraints, this means they must be satisfied on the, what you call the initial hypersurface, I mean the hypersurface where you give initial data. And that's then a question whether you can actually find a consistent data set for the initial values of fields. And that's what many people have investigated, and this question is now be answered in the affirmative. Yeah, so you can find initial data satisfying the constraints such that the evolution of the gravitational field of the metric is unique up to coordinate transformations. Let me mention at least the most important names here in this. So these are some historic remarks. So there is an early theorem by Choquet-Bruyat in 1952. And I just write this down and I explain a little bit. So it says that, okay, we give a space, a hypersurface, spatial hypersurface sigma. Then we have a three-dimensional metric HAB on it. And of course, we have to also impose something like the velocities of HAB. Now, velocities of HAB is a little bit coordinate-dependent statement. So what you specify are the components of the so-called second fundamental form that was briefly mentioned earlier, that it's important concept in differential geometry, which is the extrinsic curvature compared to the intrinsic one that comes from HAB. So this is the three metric, the three-dimensional metric, and this is the second fundamental form. So let this be an initial data set, and initial data set satisfying the vacuum constraints equations, the vacuum constraint equations. Now, so this is what we have here. So I should have emphasized that these are, of course, the vacuum equations. Constraint equations. Then there exists a space-time. There exists a space-time, okay, the manifold with the metric satisfying the Einstein, so all Einstein vacuum equations, the Einstein vacuum equations with okay, this hypersurface here embedded into M. So this is the hypersurface, okay, being space-like surface with induced metric HAB and second fundamental form KCD. So this theorem, this early theorem, guarantees local existence and uniqueness. And there is an extension of this to really a global existence. So Choquet-Bruyat and Geroch in 1969. I will not write it out in full mathematical glory, but it gives a global existence. Global existence. I mean, I should say this is a local existence and uniqueness, and it gives a global existence here. Of this evolution from the initial data. So we have a unique solution given this initial data. Now, since then, there were many other theorems with increasing generality of in which class of functions this initial data live, and also stability questions. So if you have a solution and if you perturb it, whether the solution survives or whether you have runaways. So an important proof was, for example, in the beginning of the 1990s by Christoph Dulo and Kleinermann, the stability of Minkowski space-time under small perturbations. And of course, it was also extended to include the right-hand side of the Einstein field equations with matter, energy momentum tensor, but of course, given certain properties of Team UNU. I should mention here, so Choquet-Bruyat, so Yvonne Choquet-Bruyat, who was pioneering this field. She's born in 1923 and already discussed this with, or still discusses with Einstein when she was visiting Princeton. And then she had this theorem and also the later theorems. So she even wrote a book, a very recommended book, at the age of 90 on general relativity, black holes, and cosmology, where of course much emphasis is given also on this mathematical treatment of Einstein field equation. So I can highly recommend this if you're interested in this particular questions. So in these theorems, the so-called global hyperbolicity of space-time is guaranteed. I mean, global hyperbolicity means that a space-time can be written as a Cartesian product of space-like hypersurface and the real numbers. And you also apply this to numerical investigation, so numerical relativity, which these days is an important subject in relativity, because the equations are so difficult that you can hardly do this by hand. So you give this initial data and then you get a globally hyperbolic space-time. Of course, there are solutions of Einstein equations which are not globally hyperbolic, for example, with closed time-like lines, so you can travel via your own future to your own past. So they don't fall into this class where the theorems hold. Yeah, and it's a question whether such solutions, for example, the ones with closed timeline curves, are really physical sensible. Although formally, they are space-time solutions of this. So let me finally discuss some further structural issues. In 1918, when asked, Einstein listed the following three principles that guided him to relativity. And let me say some words on that. So the first is, of course, the equivalence principle. This was the most important principle for Einstein, and we had discussed it already, so I will not say at this point anything more. The equivalence principle, as I try to explain to you, led to the geometric formulation of the gravitational field and to the idea to have a metric there and to look for field equations for the metric. Then Einstein mentioned also two other principles. So the second is the principle of general covariance. Now, and this is what gave the theory its name. General theory of relativity, allgemeine Relativitätstheorie, as Einstein called it. So that's due to this principle. And Einstein mentioned also a third one called Mach's principle. Okay, let me say something to two and three. Now, what the principle of general covariance means here is just to express the absence of an absolute space-time, like absolute time in Newton, or like in special relativity, the absolute role that inertial systems play. So that what Einstein had in mind, all reference frames are on equal footing. And he wanted to devise field equations that express this through their tensorial nature. So that, I mean, these are tensor equations, and that the form of these equations hold in for any frames or for any coordinate systems. Yeah, so this is the tensorial nature of the field equations. So they have this generally covariant form. Of course, in special relativity, you already have a special covariance, namely with respect to Poincaré transformations, but not with respect to arbitrary, say, accelerations. But here, and this was felt as a big deficit by Einstein of special relativity, this is why he looked after special relativity for a theory with general covariance. And this you can achieve by having tensor equations that have the same form in all coordinate systems, or as we said, are invariant under diffeomorphisms. Now, there was a discussion at this in these early days that to some extent was going on also quite recently, because there was a colleague, Kretschmann, who wrote also a paper and pointed out that in principle you can write any theory in a generally covariant form by just introducing some unobservable elements. So you can also, as you pointed out, write Newton's equation in this form. But as Einstein replied then, he said, yes, this is of course mathematically correct that you can do that, but in, say, Newton's case, you still can, what one calls, deparameterize it, so you can see that this is just an absolute structure in disguise. But then in general relativity, you have no absolute structure. And in recent years, people have proven some theorems to the extent that you cannot deparameterize general relativity in this sense by Kretschmann. So one should not call this a trivial principle as it's sometimes stated, but it's a natural principle to assume if you want to have a theory that, loosely speaking, is invariant under coordinate transformations. And this is what the Einstein equations are. I mean, they are tensor equations. And so that's what the theory gave its name. I mean, John Wheeler suggested that it's more probably called geometrodynamics, which is true, like electrodynamics. This captures more the spirit of the theory more than general relativity, because it's a dynamics of the metric and of the curvature, and geometrodynamics, this is what it is. But for historic reasons, we usually still call it special or here general relativity. Okay, let me leave it for that. I mean, one could say certainly a whole hour could talk about this. And let me say also something about Mach's principle. Now, this was extremely important in the development of general relativity, as Einstein admitted several times. He also met Ernst Mach when Ernst Mach was already very old, and discussed with him, but he later abandoned it. Now, Ernst Mach was a physicist, but also a philosopher of science, who was based in Vienna, at least in his later years. And so lived until 1916, and in the years before 1916, Einstein had discussions with him. And he was very influential, so he wrote an influential book. In German, it's called Die Mechanik in ihrer Entwicklung, historisch-kritisch dargestellt, so the mechanics in its evolution, described in a historically critical way. So maybe I just write here influential mechanics book from 1883. Well, the first edition is from 1883. And if you look at this book, so I also have it at home on my bookshelf, it's easy reading. I mean, it can serve as a pedagogical introduction for mechanics, at least in the 19th century spirit. I mean, Mach also did original work in physics, like the Mach numbers. So if you move with more than the speed of sound and so on. But what is important in this context, and why this name is mentioned in this context, is actually the last part of this book, which is about the philosophy of space and time, and it contains a detailed criticism of the concepts of absolute space and absolute time, so against Newton. So perhaps you remember what I did very early in chapter one, when we had a brief history of space-time and the Newtonian concepts of absolute space and time. And he was one of the persons who have very explicitly expressed their criticism. So critique of the concepts of absolute space and absolute time. So against Newton. So for example, we discussed this bucket experiment of Newton, and well, basically the argument was that these concepts have no observational meaning. You cannot observe an absolute space and absolute time. So if Newton in his bucket experiment claims to have proven the existence of absolute space by having this rotation curve of the water inside the bucket, so Mach claims, well, all we can say that this happens with respect to the far away fixed stars, with respect to the matter in the universe. And it's not clear what happens if you remove all the matter in the universe. So in his opinion, this was a relative effect, and he wanted to introduce only relative concepts like motion with respect to the remaining matter in the universe, or time, not an absolute time, but only time that certain clocks or physical clocks measure. Now, Einstein was influenced by this, and what was important for the development of general relativity was especially one part, namely the idea that inertia is determined by the matter in the universe. So say the fixed stars, the far away stars, they determine the inertial motion of objects. That's what Einstein thought is the content of Mach's principle. Although, I mean, Mach did not formulate it in that way. So Einstein originally thought that T mu nu of x determines G mu nu of x uniquely, I mean up to coordinate transformations. Matter determines inertia. No matter, no inertia. That's what Einstein thought. So that the metric is really completely determined by the mass distribution in the universe. So this would mean that, say, the centrifugal force that you experience if you're on a roundabout would be due to the far away fixed stars and your relative motion. Now, of course, in these early days, it was not yet understood how to deal really with these complicated Einstein equations, and I discussed a couple of minutes before the initial value problem and so on. So we know, and it was soon clear also then to Einstein, that this here is not correct. So this is not the case. Now, for example, already the solution, the Minkowski space-time, is a solution of the vacuum field equations, and it possesses inertia, and this inertia is expressed by the Christoffel symbols, by the connection, which also in flat space-time are there as a mathematical concept. In inertial coordinates, the gammas are zero, but in non-inertial coordinates, they are there. And you have learned in the course and also in exercises that centrifugal forces and Coriolis forces can be described by Christoffel symbols in flat space-time. One should also emphasize that Mach's principle is really 19th century philosophy and physics, and very much rooted in the spirit of action at a distance theory, not yet in the spirit of local field theory. Mach thought in terms of this Newtonian ideas of long-range forces and so on, and this is not our modern point of view. So today we formulate things locally in physics by local concepts and not by action at a distance. Okay, so once Einstein had understood that, and this was in the years after 1917, he abandoned Mach's principle. Later he said, vom Mach'schen Prinzip soll man eigentlich nicht mehr reden. Yeah, so you should never again speak on the Mach principle. Still, people mention it, and will maybe continue to mention it, but one must distinguish between, say, the historic, the philosophical, and the physical aspects of this principle. Historic is... there's a historical importance, that's clear, and this was an extremely influential work, the philosophical also, if you see it generally, say in the sense of absolute versus relative and how this is implemented is also still important. But in the physical sense concerning this idea here, then there in this sense one really should forget about it. So today in relativity, one, when the name Mach is mentioned, usually one does not mention Mach's principle, but Machian effects. So you will learn about that in the last chapter, in chapter 9, when we see, the influence of a rotating mass on its neighborhood, on inertial systems that are in the neighborhood and they are co-influenced by this rotating mass. Yeah, some final remarks on the connection gamma. So I will not write this down. You can read some paragraphs in the script, and also there is, of course, literature. So according to Einstein, inertia and gravity are more or less the same, equal in essence. In his words, wesensgleich. You know, in German, wesensgleich means equal in essence or spirit. And this is this is what determines the inertia, as I already have mentioned. Weil, Hermann Weyl called it Führungsfeld, so kind of guiding field, and today we call it connection. So in general relativity, the connection is determined by the metric, but in more general theories, it's just independent. So it's actually the gamma that replaces absolute space. And which is independent, as I have said before, independent of the existence of matter. Yeah, so you can have inertia without, as Mach thought, really to have matter there, stars, with respect to which you move or rotate. And inertia follows from the unavoidable coupling of matter to gamma. Yeah, so recall the geodesic equation for test particles, where this here enters. So this gamma that determines the inertia in the motion of the point particles, and the inertia that you see then also in the Newtonian limit. Now gamma is not a field on space-time. Yeah, it can not have an exactly zero value, only in particular coordinates it can be zero, but it's not a tensor. So this is important to notice, because it means that you cannot assume to have inertia determined by matter, because you needed this gamma to describe the motion of matter. So far for the chapter 6. The next chapter will be then an introduction to gravitational waves. One of the most exciting solutions of Einstein's theory that have no analog in the Newtonian theory. So bye-bye for now, and until next time.